إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فالسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أيها الأحبة، we continue this afternoon looking at الأصول الثلاثة, or the three fundamental principles. And I believe where we left off the last time was where the author said, "No, may Allah have mercy upon you, that it is obligatory that every Muslim male and female learn the following three issues and act upon them. First, that Allah created us." Okay, and we spoke about this already. Provides for us, and He did not abandon us. Rather, He sent us a messenger. So whoever obeys Him, he will enter paradise, and whoever disobeys Him, he will enter the fire. And the evidence is His statement, Subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Inna arsalna ilaykum rasulan shahidan alaykum kama arsalna ila fir'auna rasula fa'asa fir'auna rasula fa'akhadnahu akhdan wabila." Meaning that verily we have sent to you a messenger to be a witness over you, as we did send a messenger to Fir'aun, but Fir'aun disobeyed the messenger, so we seized him with a severe punishment. الثانية. And this is where we will pick up this afternoon, inshallah ta'ala. So the first matter was that of الربوبية, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us and He provides for us. And His blessing upon us is that He did not leave us alone. He didn't leave us to figure out how to live alone, but rather He sent us the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whom if we were to obey and follow, we would be destined for paradise, and if we were to disobey him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then we would be destined for the hellfire. Then he says the second matter that we must learn is أَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَرْضَى أَن يُشْرَكَ مَعَهُ أَحَدٌ فِي عِبَادَتِهِ لَا مَلَكٌ مُقَرَّبٌ وَلَا نَبِيٌّ مُرْسَلٌ وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. Basically what he's saying is, we should know that Allah is not pleased, that Allah does not consent that anyone be associated with him in worship of him subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether that be a close angel or a dispatched messenger, a prophet whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent. And the evidence that he cites is the ayah in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what means, "And the masajid," meaning the places of worship, "are for Allah alone. So do not supplicate to anyone along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." So here, let's begin. أَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَرْضَى أَن يُشْرَكَ مَعَهُ أَحَدٌ فِي عِبَادَتِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not consent, and He subhanahu wa ta'ala is not happy and not pleased that anyone would worship other than Him or worship someone or something alongside Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the greatest of calamities and the greatest of sins that could ever be committed anywhere and at any time. We are speaking of the sin of ashirk, polytheism. Worshipping someone or something either alongside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the greatest form of injustice. As Luqman alayhi as-salam was advising his son, Ya bunayya la tushrik billah, inna shirka la zulmun azim. So he says to his son, La tushrik billah, do not associate anyone or anything with Allah. Inna shirka, for indeed, a shirk is a great injustice. Just as a tawheed, singling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out in worship, is the greatest form of justice. Okay? So, a shirk, as we said, is the gravest and the greatest of all sins. Know that sins in general, whether they be minor or major, and no matter how big those sins may be, no matter how great those sins may be, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them if He so pleases. All sins are forgivable, if you will, except for shirk. What is the proof of that? First of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. The basic meaning of that, say to my slaves, my servants, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِي, O my servants, who have transgressed against themselves, who have wronged themselves. How? By committing sins. By disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا. Do not despair. Do not lose hope. In what? لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Do not despair of the mercy of Allah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. For indeed, Allah forgives all sins. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. For indeed, He is the most forgiving, the most merciful. But then, this is restricted. When we say all sins, does it include a shirk? No. When we look to the Quran, when we look to the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, I believe I had mentioned it before, and that is, we do not simply look at one text and then run with it. We look at that text within the context of the Quran, within the context of the authentic Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Quran is explained by the Quran and by the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So we have certain verses, we recite them, we read them, but the meaning may not be very clear to us. Where are we going to find the meanings? Perhaps in some other verses in the Quran, they will clarify what we read in one place, or in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. أُوتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, I was granted the Quran and something similar alongside it. That is, his authentic Sunnah, salawatu rabbi wa salamuhu alayhi. Just a quick example of that. We're going to look now. We said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا, that indeed Allah forgives all sins. Okay, we will look how it is restricted, if you will, from evidence in the Quran. But what about something that has evidence in the Sunnah? Well, you recall the ayat in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of fasting, right? And when do we begin our fast and when do we end our fast? حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. So, we're allowed to eat at night until when? Until such time that the white thread is visible from the black thread. حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. At the time of Fajr, the break of true dawn. Okay, so some of the Sahaba, how do they understand that particular text? Well, he put a white thread and a black thread under his pillow. And so he would check. I mean, they didn't have lights like we do and so forth, so everything is off, it's dark, right? Put the black and white together, they both look the same. You could not distinguish between the two of them. But when he felt it was bright enough, oh, this one is white, this one is black, now we have to stop eating. The fast begins. But the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam explained that this is not what was meant by that particular verse. But rather it is the break of true dawn, and this is how you know it is actually looking visibly into the sky, and you can see that. Alright. In any event, so here, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا, that indeed Allah forgives all sins. Really, each and every sin without exception? No, there is an exception. And that exception is mentioned in the Quran itself, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَن يَشَاءُ. So he says subhanahu wa ta'ala here what means, indeed, Allah does not forgive. Allah does not forgive. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ. Does not forgive what? أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ. That something should be worshipped alongside him or other than him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. And he forgives everything besides that from whomever he wishes. So now we see where the exception is made. So all sins, major or minor, can be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except for this one sin, which is ashirk. إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةَ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارُ. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what means, indeed he who associates others with Allah, that is anyone who worships other than Allah or something or someone alongside Allah, I'm sort of explaining that in the translation because we have to understand what ashirk is. Ashirk is not only that you worship something besides Allah. No, it could be that you worship Allah and along with Allah you worship someone or something else. Okay? As many of the mushrikeen did. As, wal'iyadu billah, some who associate themselves with Islam and the Muslims do. They say that they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but along with Allah, they will pray to Allah, their five daily prayers, they will fast for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but in times of hardship, when some calamity befalls them, rather than turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will turn to someone whom they refer to as a saint, a wali. They will go to his grave. This is a person who has died, but happened to be a righteous person. So they ask of him, oh so and so, relieve me of the burden that is overwhelming me. Whatever, they will pray to someone or something other than Allah. They will pray to one of the angels, for example. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. So then, yes, they worship Allah, but they have committed shirk. And here, we are told, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ. Whoever does such an act, where they worship either other than Allah, or someone or something alongside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then indeed, what happens? Allah has forbidden him paradise. That person doesn't have a chance of entering al-Jannah or paradise, and his refuge is the fire. That is his ultimate destination. As a matter of fact, you might be surprised to know that all the prophets, including the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, were addressed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ, meaning that it has already been revealed to you and to those before you. وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ. It was revealed to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and those before you, the prophets who came before you. What was revealed to them? لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Yes, even the prophets were told by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you should associate anything with Allah, your deeds would surely become worthless. All of your deeds would be destroyed. They would be meaningless. They would hold no weight on the Day of Judgment. And you would surely be among the losers. Okay? بَلِ اللَّهَ فَعْبُدْ. Rather worship Allah. وَكُنْ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. And be amongst the grateful. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even warned his messengers, including the messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I think, especially here, you probably learned from a young age when you do dua al-istiftah after takbirat al-ihram, right? One of the things that you recite, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَبِذَلِكَ أُمِرْتُ وَأَنَا أَوَّلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Right? So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it clear the issue of worship and every type of worship. Say, إِنَّ صَلَاتِي, indeed my prayer, wa nusuki, and all of my rites of sacrifice, قل إن صلاتي ونسكي ومحياي ومماتي and my living and my dying are all for Allah, the Lord of the worlds. لله رب العالمين. So we have to understand this is the issue of a tawheed, and it is the greatest of all issues, as we have been saying from the beginning. And there are just so many verses in the Quran all speaking about this particular issue of at-tawheed and ash-shirk. They are opposites. At-tawheed, maintaining the unity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worshipping none other than Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And as I said, this is the greatest form of justice, whereas ash-shirk is the greatest form of injustice. As far as shirk is concerned, then the scholars, based on the Quran, based on the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, have categorized it and said that there are two types of shirk. The first one is known as ash-shirku al-akbar, and the second one is ash-shirku al-asghar. Ash-shirku al-akbar, major shirk, that refers to, things which are absolutely clear to us. I gave you examples of people worshipping statues and idols. The Christians, for example, their shirk is clear, is evident. Although some people say, hang on a second, but the Christians, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala referred to them as Ahlul Kitab. Yes, they are Ahlul Kitab. They were granted a scripture, but they strayed and they committed shirk. This is why, from the sayings of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu arda, is ما رأيت شركا أعظم من شرك النصارى. He says, I have not seen a shirk, a form of shirk, greater than the shirk of the Christians. They commit shirk, of course they do, because they have set up partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because they have given what belongs to Allah to others as well. So they believe in the Trinity, for example. They believe that Isa alayhi salam is the son of God. So what do? They worship him. They literally worship him. You know, the symbol that they have, the cross, if you notice that they bow before that statue of Isa alayhi salam when they go to their churches, they wear these crosses around their necks. Many things that they do, they call upon Jesus. They call upon Isa alayhi salam. They call upon the Holy Ghost, Jibreel alayhi salam. So this is clearly a form of shirk. So these are forms of shirk, and they are known that khalas. These are so severe and so serious that they take a person outside the fold of Islam. That person can no longer be considered a Muslim. They do tawaf, they circumambulate, not only around the Kaaba, which is the only place that we are allowed to do tawaf, but they may do it around graves. Correct? We know of many places where they do this. They make dua, they supplicate to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They believe that they are human beings, individuals. You know, some of the extreme Sufi groups, they believe that there are individuals who have some control over what happens in this universe, in this creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they believe that these individuals can intercede on their behalf and change something that is destined for them. This is all major shirk, and something which takes a person outside the fold of Islam. Okay. Then there is something called ash-shirku al-asghar. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and by the way, again, ash-shirk, as we said, is to set up partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and is something which is not forgiven. This is major shirk. So as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. And among the people are those who take other than Allah as equals. Right? They take them as partners. They love them as they should love Allah. How does that love manifest itself? It manifests itself in the way that they carry out acts of worship towards those other beings. Okay. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam also told us, as we find in the hadith of Ubadah ibn Samit radiyallahu anhu wa arda, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that whoever bears witness that there is none worthy of worship besides Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. Now these are some of the texts talking about the merits, if you will, of a tawheed, which is the opposite of a shirk. We're talking now about a shirk al-akbar, which takes a person outside the fold of Islam. So whoever bears witness that there's none worthy of worship but Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah, and that Isa, Jesus alayhi salam, is the slave and the messenger of Allah, and his word which he cast upon Maryam, and a spirit from him, one of the created spirits from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that paradise is truth, and that the fire is truth, Allah will do what? Allah will enter him into paradise according to his deeds. In other words, what level he gets in paradise will be according to his deeds. So a person who maintains tawheed, who avoids a shirk, such a person will definitely enter into paradise. Then listen to this beautiful hadith, which teaches us so much. Not only something about at-tawheed, but also we learn something of the vast mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a hadith Qudsi. In it, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, it's a hadith of Anas radiallahu anhu, found in Sahih al-Tirmidhi, and the hadith before that is found in both Bukhari and Muslim. So in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah azza wa jalla says, Yabna Adam, O son of Adam, so long as you call upon me and ask of me. So as long as you continue to worship none other than Allah, your hopes are only in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You only ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, as long as you call upon me and you worship only me, you ask only of me, I shall forgive you for what you have done and I shall not mind. It doesn't matter. As long as you only turn to me, you do not commit shirk, you do not turn to anyone other than me. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is saying this. Then I shall forgive you for whatever you have done, no matter what it is, I will forgive it. And I will not mind doing so. Then he continues, O son of Adam, if your sins were to reach the clouds of the sky, and were you then to ask forgiveness of me, I would forgive you. Again, at-tawheed. As long as you worship none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not an excuse now for us to sin continuously. No, I mean, this is not the case. Believe me, if that is the case, then we will find that Allah azza wa jal will not grant us the tawfiq, the ability to do this. Because the hearts are in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we're talking about a person who is sincere. We sincerely believe in Allah, but we do sin. We try our best to avoid sin, but due to weaknesses, whatever, we sin. And we may continuously do so. But every time, if we turn back to Allah, we don't believe that we can go to the Imam in the Masjid, or we can go to this wali or that wali, as the Christians do in their churches, and they go to ask for forgiveness. Oh Father, I have sinned. Huh? The confession. And then he says to them that, okay, you've been forgiven. They go then confess their sins to other than Allah. No. We confess our sins before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if your sins were to reach the clouds of the sky, I mean, imagine how many sins. Wow. And then you were to beg of Allah's forgiveness. Not turn to anyone else. Realize that there is none who forgives sins but Allah. Allah azza wa jalla says, I would forgive you. And I don't mind. I will not mind to do so. O son of Adam, you think that was a lot? Listen to this. Were you to come to me with sins nearly as great as the earth, an earth full of sins, on the day of Qiyamah now we're talking about, if you were to come to me, meet me on the day of judgment, even if you did not repent from those sins. Imagine, even if a person did not repent before dying, if a person were to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with all of those sins, he says subhanahu wa ta'ala, and were you then to face me, ascribing no partner to me? You lived your life, yes, you may have wronged, you may have sinned, you may have transgressed, but you never ever turned to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You worshipped always Allah and Allah alone. You've always known that good and harm can only come from Allah, ultimately. Because you remember the hadith in which the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said to Abdullah ibn Abbas, Ya ghulam, inni u'allimuka kalimat, ihfadillahi ihfadhk, ila akhir al-hadith. And in that hadith, وَإِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِمْ بِاللَّهِ. In that hadith where he said to him, O young boy, I will teach you some words. I'm going to give you some advice. Remember it well. And from the advice that he gave him was, and when you ask, ask of Allah alone. وَإِذَا سَأَلْتَ وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ, and when you seek help from Allah. فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ. And of course, in that hadith is where we learn that if everyone on the face of the earth got together and they agreed that they were going to bring some good to you, they would never accomplish it, not unless Allah had willed it already. And were they to agree that they are going to harm you in some way, no harm would reach you unless it had already been destined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this was to happen to you, not because they decided. So you live your life according to this, knowing that everything comes from Allah, knowing that you are fully dependent upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You never worshipped anyone or anything. You never even dreamed of doing so. The creation, you know that they have, even though the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is as great as he is, the best and most beloved of Allah's creation, but you would never think once in your life when some calamity befalls you or you are going through some great difficulty, you never even dream of saying, Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad, relieve my distress. Never. Because he himself, salawatu Rabbi wa salamuhu alayhi, used to turn to Allah. And he taught us to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we were to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and our sins were so many that they would practically fill the entire earth, but we meet Allah never having committed shirk. We meet Allah having not associated anyone or anything with him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I would bring you forgiveness nearly as great as it. So just as you came with these sins, then similarly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would bring forgiveness for us. There's another great hadith as well that I must share with you. It is a hadith known as Hadith al-Bitaqah. The hadith of, I don't know, you want to call it a card or a passport to paradise, if you will. What is this hadith? An amazing hadith in which we learn that on the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will single one person out. He will single a man out. And before that man, there will be 99 scrolls. Those scrolls contain what that person did in this life. And each scroll extends as far as the eye can see. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks that individual if he objects to anything that is in those scrolls. This is from the justice of Allah azza wa jal. Our books will be presented before us. We have all the luxury to read through them. Okay? Have you read everything? Do you object to anything that is in them? Did my scribes who used to write those things, did they wrong you in any way? Did they write something that does not belong there? No. I admit to everything. Yeah, I did all of that stuff. Wow. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask that individual, so do you have any excuse? Do you have something that you can present which will do away with all of those things? And the man will say that he does not. I don't have any excuses. I don't have anything that I can present that can wipe all of that away. 99 scrolls? Wow. I don't have anything. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him, but today you will not be wronged. This day, there will be no wrong done to you. Okay? And no matter how small the good you may have done, all of that will be presented before you as well. طيب. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him, but there is something that you do have. Yes, you say you have no excuse, but you do have something. And this something will be brought on like I said, maybe some of them are translated as a piece of paper, you know, a card, if you will. Okay? And it would be said to that person that this here outweighs everything else. And he would be shocked. How can it be? This slip of paper, this card is going to outweigh these 99 scrolls. And that card will be presented. And on that card is the Shahada. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. This is what that person lived by in this world. This is why we keep stressing the importance of a tawheed. Because it is our passport to Jannah. That bitaqa, we are counting on it. It will outweigh everything. It will outweigh everything. So it will be placed on one side of the balance, and the 99 scrolls will be placed on the other side of the balance. And this small card, this small piece of paper on which there is the Shahada, will outweigh the 99 scrolls. Because nothing, but nothing can be compared to La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. If a person lives by it. Yes, a person can live by La ilaha illallah and still sin. It is possible, right? Because we are not perfect. As a matter of fact, the nature of humankind is that we will sin. Kullu bani Adama khatta. Kullu bani Adama khatta. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam told us that all of the children of Adam are prone to err. As a matter of fact, he told us that if we were such a people that did not sin at all, the angels would be shaking our hands at our bedsides. If we never sinned, Allah would replace us with the people who did sin, and then they would repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we are human beings. Don't think that, you know, because you say La ilaha illallah and live by La ilaha illallah, it means you will never sin. No. It means you will avoid sins. It means you will sin much less the closer you live according to La ilaha illallah, yes. In any event, these are some of the ahadith which, subhanallah, give us great hope, which really make us or drive us to live according to this tawheed and to avoid shirk of all kinds. There's so much shirk going on around us in this world, and we need to avoid it all. We need to detest it. And we need to warn the people from it. This is what the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam came with, the message that he came with. Alright, so we said that is ashirkul akbar, and the opposite of it is at-tawheed, and we spoke briefly about some of the merits or the virtues of at-tawheed. The other type or the other form of shirk is known as ashirk al-asghar. What is it? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam told his companions that there's something I fear for you more than anything else. And it is ashirku al-asghar. The thing I fear most for you is ashirku al-asghar. Then they asked, what is ashirku al-asghar? What is it? And he responded to them by saying it is al-riya. Al-riya. Ashirku al-asghar. Minor shirk. It does not take one out of the fold of Islam. Because the person is not worshipping other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala openly. I mean, in their heart, they do not believe that this form of worship should be directed to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They know that it should be directed towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they take others as partners, if you will, to Allah in that they want praise from those people. Ar-riya, doing something to show off. Doing something because you want people to speak well of you. That is your intention for doing it. Understand? So when you are carrying out that act of worship, it's not like you are praying to a statue or an idol. You're not even praying to that particular individual whom you want praise from. You are praying to Allah. But for example, you will, you know, perfect your prayer. Why? Because you're in front of others and you want people to think that you're so good. Whatever that act of worship may be. You do things, yes, you know that they should be done for Allah, but at the same time you're like, but I just, you know, how nice if other people could see me. Alright, this is basically, in a nutshell, what riya is. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not pleased with that either. As a matter of fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, you know, out of everyone, of course, He is the one who does not want any allies. He doesn't want anybody to be worshipped alongside Him. Okay, and whoever does a good deed, who is associating others with Allah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I will leave him with his association. This is in Hadith Qudsi. It says, أنا أغنى الشركاء يعني الشرك. I have no need for any partners. I'm the one who doesn't want anyone more than anybody else. So if you do anything and you associate them along with me, then I leave you and that partnership of yours. In other words, that deed of yours will be rejected. It will not be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And know something else. I mean, just try to think of this. How is it that you're going to do all of this for someone whose heart is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I mean, who are we trying to impress? All of these acts of worship must be only for Allah. When we try to impress others, what are they going to do for you? What are their words of praise going to do for us ultimately? Where are they going to get us? But know this, that ultimately, sooner or later, this is what will happen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause the opposite of what you want to take place. In other words, He will expose you. And this is found, you know, if you look to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will find that evidence. Al-mu'aqabatu binaqidil qasd. So you will be punished by having the opposite of what you wanted accomplished. So you do things to show off. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us in a hadith that whoever does things to show the people, for example, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will expose you. Whatever you are concealing, whatever it is that you are hiding, they will know that you are not sincere. They will know that you are not sincere. And subhanAllah, we actually have experienced that, haven't we? We see some people, they're trying so hard, you know, to be all righteous and mighty and whatever else. But subhanAllah, you're just not comfortable. You know that there's something wrong. And eventually you catch that person. You see that there's something about them. They are exposed. This is something you will find in the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, where that person's hidden agenda, whatever they are trying to accomplish, it will be exposed that this person is not sincere. They're not doing this for the sake of Allah, but rather for personal gain. And all of us, you know, have heard that hadith about those individuals who'll be the first ones to be tossed into the hellfire, have we not? The mujahid. I mean, a person who apparently was fighting for the sake of Allah. The one who was given a great deal of wealth and who apparently spent it for the sake of Allah. The one who had memorized the Quran and was given great knowledge and who apparently used that knowledge to guide the people and to judge between the people, and he used to recite the Quran day and night. But each of them, when they come before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah, and they are asked, so what did you do with that gift that I bestowed upon you? They say, oh, I did this, and it was all for your sake, it was all for your sake. To each and every one of them, it will be said, you have lied. As for the mujahid, no, you said you did that, so people would say about you that you are shuja', that you were brave, that you were a great warrior, and it was said about you, to the hellfire. The one who was given a great deal of wealth, really you spent it for my sake? No. You spent it so people would say, oh, how generous you are, how big-hearted you are, and it was said about you, to the hellfire. The one who was reciting the Quran and judging the people, for the sake of Allah, no, you have lied. You did it so the people would say, wow, what a wonderful reciter, what a great scholar. All of that was not done for the sake of Allah. So Allah will reject it, will not accept it to the hellfire for that individual as well. Tayyib. So, a question might arise where we say that, hang on a second, sometimes it so happens that I do something and really I do it for the sake of Allah. I don't do it for anybody else. My intention before and while and after doing that action was only to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It may be, just as an example, you were in a gathering and somebody said, can you say a few words? I mean, remind us of Allah, a short tazkira. I mean, you are not prepared and you just, you know, wow. So you turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help, and you began speaking, and subhanAllah, what you said had a good impact on the people. Something that you did, whatever. I'm just giving an example. And after that, you heard the people speaking about what you had just done. Wow, that was a great tazkira. I didn't know that person was capable of that. MashaAllah. How wonderful. And you heard that and you were like, Alhamdulillah, that's nice. I'm glad that people liked it. Is that a form of shirk? Do you know the Sahaba asked the Prophet ﷺ the very same question? They said, one of us may do a good deed, and we do it for the sake of Allah, but then the people start praising him, and upon hearing that, we become pleased with what we hear. But you know, that's human nature. Of course, if somebody praises you, alhamdulillah, you feel good about it. It's a natural reaction. But you didn't intend behind what you did to get that praise. That's not why you were doing it, but it came your way. So the Prophet ﷺ said that no, that for such a believer it is an early glad tiding. It is an early glad tiding for that person. This is what it is. It's a glad tiding for that person from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It comes to you early. That inshallah this is accepted by Allahu tabaraka wa ta'ala. Alright? So again, to conclude this segment, we say a shirk is something to be aware of, to be cautious of. Stay away from it. Remember, live by that hadith. And I continuously remind people of that hadith. The hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhumah. يا غلام إني أعلمك كلمات احفظ الله يحفظك احفظ الله تجده تجاهك وإذا سألت فاسأل البلاء. Until the end of that hadith, you will find it in Riyad al-Salihin, you will find it in many books of hadith. The advice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Abdullah ibn Abbas, oh young boy, I will teach you some words. So everything rests in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What do you want from impressing the people? Everyone and everything is dependent upon Allah. So why turn to that which is weak? When you pray, when you supplicate, when you ask, when you seek help, turn to none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who are in their graves, individuals, no matter how righteous or pious they may be, they can do nothing for us. Ultimately, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who can assist us in each and everything. So, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. It is clear that we should worship none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should call upon none other than Allah Azza wa Jal. Then he continues and he says the third matter. Okay, so we spoke about the rububiyya, where Allah Azza wa Jal created us and he provides for us and so on and so forth. And the second matter was the issue of avoiding shirk, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not pleased and he does not consent to us having partners with him, tabaraka wa ta'ala. The third matter, he says then, is أَنَّ مَنْ أَطَاعَ الرَّسُولَ وَوَحَّدَ اللَّهَ لَا يَجُوزُ لَهُ مُوَالَاتُ مَنْ حَادَّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَلَوْ كَانَ أَقْرَبَ قَرِيبٍ وَالدَّلِيلُ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى. So he's saying basically that whoever obeys the messenger, okay, so now, and singles Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out in worship, okay, it is not permissible for him to have allegiance to those who oppose Allah. So now we're talking about at-tawheed in a little bit more depth. Okay, so you don't worship anyone but Allah, alhamdulillah, excellent. You obey the messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you act according to his sunnah, alhamdulillah, wonderful. But if you are true to Allah, if you are sincere in your obedience of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then it is not permissible for such a person to have allegiance to those who oppose Allah and his Messenger, even if they are his closest relatives. And the evidence for this is in the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لا تجد قوما يؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر يوادون من حاد الله ورسوله ولو كانوا آباءهم أو أبناءهم أو إخوانهم أو عشيرتهم أولئك كتب في قلوبهم الإيمان وأيدهم بروح منه ويدخلهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه أولئك حزب الله ألا إن حزب الله هم المفلحون. The brief meaning of that ayah, you will not find any people who believe in Allah and the last day making friendship with those who oppose Allah and His Messenger, even though they were their fathers or their sons or their brothers or their kindred. For such people, that is, He has written faith in their hearts and strengthened them with a ruh, with a spirit from Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we will admit them to gardens of paradise under which rivers flow to dwell therein forever. Allah is pleased with them and they with Him. That is, they are pleased with Him. They are the party of Allah. Verily, it is the party of Allah that will be the successful. Now, we know this particular matter, and again, it's one of the most important and also at the same time one of the most sensitive issues that people can speak about today. And that is the issue of what we refer to as al-wala'u wal-bara, loyalty and disavowal. Love and hatred, if you will. Loyalty to Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to the believers. Having love for Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the believers. Loyalty, love, allegiance to them. And disavowal, disassociation, if you will, from those who oppose Allah and His Messenger and the believers. As I said, it is a very sensitive issue, and one of the reasons is that it is not understood well by the people, because it is the very opponents of Allah who try to make us think that, you know, when you say you hate something, you know, for Muslims, I mean, of course, they can hate whatever they want. But when we, the moment that the Muslim says that he or she hates something, oh, they're going to be violent. Sadly though, some Muslims have given them that impression because of the way that we misbehave. Because of our misunderstanding also of the text of the Quran and the Sunnah, where we try to take the law into our own hands and we do things that are not permitted in Islam, but we do them in the name of Islam. So here, let's try to understand this matter as well as possible, but we'll try to make it brief. I mean, it is an issue that we could talk about for at great length. But let's just try to make a few things clear. We said al-wala. Al-wala meaning to have, as we said, allegiance and love for someone. And in this case, we are saying for Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the believers. That's it. Our allegiance is to them. Our love must be for Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and whoever follows them. And they are the believers. These are the people that deserve that we be on their side. Right? Hizbullah. Not the group that they're Hizb al-Shaytan, actually. They call themselves Hizbullah, but they're Hizb al-Shaytan. But we're talking about really Hizbullah, that is the party of Allah. Right? That's it. We stand for the truth. We live according to La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. The believers, we don't show enmity towards them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us how we should be with one another. We are like one body. Even if there are Muslims amongst us who are sinners and so on and so forth, but as long as they testify that there is none worthy of worship besides Allah and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the Messenger of Allah, they live according to Tawheed. They do not set up partners with Allah. We love them. The closer a person adheres to this deen, to this way of life, al-Islam, the greater our love for them. This is how we gauge. I mean, how much we love someone is not based on how they look, is not based on the size of their bank account or the size of their car or their home. No. How much we love someone is based upon what we can see and what we perceive of their closeness to Allah. The more a person is adherent, the closer a person seems to be following the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, the greater love we will have for that person. Why? Because they are showing their love for Allah. We love people for the sake of Allah. This is the bottom line. This is the type of allegiance we're talking about. Unsur akhaka zaliman aw mazluman. We will be at our fellow Muslim side under all circumstances, whether they are oppressed or they are oppressors. Yes, even if they are oppressors, they ask him, Ya Rasulullah, how? We understand that if they are oppressed, we should stand by them and we should assist them. Sure, but how can we stand by a fellow Muslim when they are the oppressors? Yes, you stand by them even then. What does that mean? It means you take them by the hand and you explain to them that what they're doing is wrong. But not that you help them in their oppression. You help them to leave that oppression, to leave the wrong that they are doing. Yes. Our wala, our loyalty, our allegiance is to Islam. It's to those who follow Islam. This is as simple as it can get. We assist the Muslims who are, you know, being wronged against those who are wronging them. Of course. I mean, right now, if you look at what's happening in the world, and the Muslims are being oppressed, of course, we may not be able to assist them physically, but with our wealth, we try to assist them. With our dua, of course, our supplications, we turn to Allah and beg of Allah to help them over their enemies, because their enemies are our enemies. We are supposed to be like one body. When one part of it ails, the rest of it ails as well. The rest of it becomes sick as well, feels the pain. So this is what we mean, in brief, when we talk about loyalty, when we talk about allegiance to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to the believers. Then we have the issue of disavowal. We disassociate ourselves, enmity if you will, towards whom? Towards those who oppose Allah, towards those who oppose the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, towards those who oppose the believers. In other words, towards the non-Muslims. But when we say that we have this enmity towards them, it doesn't mean that we are violent towards them. We have to look at all of these texts within context, right? Look at the Quran, look at the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, look at how he lived with non-Muslims. He is the one who understood the Quran better than anyone else because it was revealed to him. Salawatu Rabbi wa salamuhu alayhi. So, when it comes to this disavowal, when it comes to this enmity towards the disbelievers, because this is what the Shaykh is saying. He is saying that anyone who obeys the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and who singles Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out in worship, then you should not have any allegiance to the non-Muslims. You should not be loyal to them. You should not take them as your allies. You should not take them as your confidants. No, they are the enemies of Allah. We have to understand that. And it is not me who is speaking. It is not the Shaykh who is speaking. All of this is found in the texts of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let me just mention a few of these texts so we understand. We understand that these are not the opinions of human beings. These are the words of Allah. There are many amongst the Muslims today who will try to explain these away. No. We cannot explain them away. As a matter of fact, when you look to the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us and informs us of what is in the hearts of the non-Muslims. They're good at hiding it. I mean, they may be very eloquent. So, you know, Bush and Obama and whoever else may, you know, deliver these eloquent lectures in Egypt and in Malaysia and wherever else, and we love the Muslims and they're contributed. It's all BS. They don't mean a word of it. وَمَا تُخْفِي صُدُورُهُمْ أَكْبَرُ What happens in the end? Actions speak louder than words. They love the Muslims so much that they send the drones over, you know, Pakistan and Afghanistan day and night. They support the Zionists who are killing the Muslims. And those who are defending themselves, they call them terrorists. Correct or not, actions speak louder than words. So this is why I say at the end of the day, it's all nonsense. They can say whatever they want. But it is the weak amongst the Muslims, those with little to no faith, who gobble it all up. Oh, see, they're with us. They're with us. Are you serious? Are you kidding me? And they're setting up bases here and there, and we see whatever they are doing. No, yeah, they're not with us. Again, although that may be the case, we cannot take the law into our own hands. The rules of the battlefield are one, and when we are, you know, roaming the land freely, and we're taking citizenship, and we have these tourist visas and whatever else, that's another issue. Okay, I mean, you can't take it into your own hands and go and blow up buildings and say, yes, this is al-bara', yeah, this is me showing enmity towards the enemies of Allah. Well, not quite. All right, because this is also against the teachings of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. I was saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran what is in their hearts. Does anybody know better? Who knows better than Allah? As I said, you may see one thing, but this is what their job is. That they will be hypocrites in front of you. They will try to sway you. They try to get you on their side. Right? They want to take you away. They want to take you away from your religion, even though they say that you have the freedom of religion. Look to the West today. Look at France, for example. Look at so many of these European countries that claim that they are the champions of democracy, but they are the first ones to ban hijab. Correct or not? Where did freedom of religion go now? Did they say that the nuns couldn't cover themselves?
No.
But the Muslim woman, because she's a terrorist, she cannot cover herself. These symbols of religion, no, you have to do away with them. So you think, you can say whatever you want, but your actions speak louder than your words. It applies to them just as it applies to us. Ala kullin. Let's look at some of these texts so that we can get a better understanding. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu. Whenever Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who have believed, then what should we do? We should pay close attention. Because this is something which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing us with, something good that we must do or something that we should avoid. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O you who have believed. So, this is Allah speaking to us. If we truly believe in Allah, if we truly believe in the meeting with Allah, if we truly believe in the last day, if we believe in heaven and hell, if we believe, if we are true believers, then these words are being addressed towards us. Then these words are for us, and we need to pay close attention, because it is not some man who is speaking, it is not some created being who is speaking. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking to me and to you. So these words should be taken to heart. O you who have believed, Ya أيها الذين آمنوا لا تتخذوا بطانة من دونكم لا يألونكم خبالا. O you who believe, take not as your bitana, as your advisors, your consultants, your confidants. But we have all these treaties with them. Anyways, don't take them as your bitana, those other than yourselves, other than the believers. Don't trust them. This is what Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us. Do not trust them. How come? Since they will not fail to do their best to corrupt you. Who is telling you this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has exposed them for who they are. He has exposed what is in their hearts. Not me, because I don't know what's in their hearts. The only way I found out was through the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He told us, don't take them, don't rely on them, don't take them as your allies, because they will do everything they can to corrupt you. I still remember when they entered Afghanistan, one of the first things that they announced and they were so proud of is that they were able to get a woman to uncover her face and be seen on television. Wow. All of that money that they spent, all of those lives that were taken, and this was their goal. This is what they're taking pride in now. I still remember that day. I still remember reading that article and listening to that news clip. Ya subhanallah. Whatever they can to corrupt us, this is what they will continue to do, to move us away from our deen. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, la tattakhidhu al-yahuda wal-nasara awliya, ba'buhum awliya'u ba'd. وَمَنْ يَتَوَلَّهُمْ مِنْكُمْ فَإِنَّهُ مِنْهُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الظَّالِمِينَ. O you who believe. Again, these are words from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we need to pay attention to. The meaning of those words, do not take the Jews and the Christians as your awliya, as your guardians, as your allies, as your confidants, as your, you know, bosom buddies. They are but awliya to one another. They are worried about one another. They will take one another's side. They will never be with you. And if any among you takes them as awliya, then surely he is one of them. It's a serious warning. He'll be just like them. Verily Allah guides not those people who are the zalimun, the wrongdoers. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, la tattakhidhu alladhina attakhadhu deenakum huzuwan wa la'iban min alladhina utul kitaba min qablikum wal kufara awliya wattaqullaha in kuntum Mu'mineen, O you who believe, take not for awliya those who take your religion for a mockery and play. From whom? From among those who were given the scripture. The Christians and Jews, don't take them also, because people are, oh, you know. No, no. Ahlul Kitab, they are also our enemies. They also don't want any good for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not take them as your awliya. And do you not see how they're making a mockery of our religion? They're taking it as a plaything. Do you not see how they insult our religion day in and day out? If you follow the news, you will see that, you know, recently there's a man in Canada who was charged because of all this, you know, supposed hate that he was spewing against the Jews. But there's worse than that being said about the Muslims in the Canadian newspapers, but that is freedom of speech. That is freedom of speech. When the hatred is aimed towards us, freedom of speech. But if something is said about them, and it is true, oh, that's hate speech, and it is a crime. And you can be tried for it. And the consequences are severe. طيب. Nor from among the disbelievers in general. So do not take them as your awliya. And have taqwa of Allah. If you are indeed believers, fear Allah. Be conscious of Allah. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تتخذوا آباءكم وإخوانكم أولياء إن استحبوا الكفر على الإيمان ومن يتولهم منكم فأولئك هم الظالمون قل إن كان آباءكم وأبناؤكم وإخوانكم وأزواجكم وعشيرتكم وأموال اقترفتموها وتجارة تخشون كسادها ومساكن ترضونها أحب إليكم من الله ورسوله وجهاد في سبيله فتربصوا حتى يأتي الله بأمره والله لا يهدي القوم الفاسقين. Briefly, it means, O you who believe, take not your fathers and your brothers as awliya if they prefer disbelief to faith. And whoever of you does so, then he is one of the zalimin, one of those who is the wrongdoers. Say, if your fathers, your sons, your brothers, your wives, your kindred and wealth that you have gained, the trade in which you fear a decline, and the dwellings in which you delight are dearer to you than Allah and His Messenger, and striving hard and fighting in His cause, then wait until Allah brings about His decision. That is torment. His torment, His punishment. And Allah guides not the people who are al-fasiqun, that is the rebellious. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about Ibrahim alayhi salam, قَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ فِي إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ. So, indeed there has been an excellent example for you in Ibrahim and those with him. Why? I'll give you the meaning of the ayah. When they said to their people, verily, we are free from you and whatever you worship besides Allah. We have rejected you, and there has started between us and you hostility and hatred forever until you believe in Allah alone. Right? So these are just a few of the ayat. I want to say, remind you of a few more. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُوا عَدُوِّي وَعَدُوَّكُمْ أَوْلِيَاءَ. O you who have believed, do not take my enemies and your enemies as awliya, as allies. Okay? تُلْقُونَ إِلَيْهِمْ بِالْمَوَدَّةِ وَقَدْ كَفَرُوا بِمَا جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ الْحَقِّ إِلَى آخِرِ الْآيَاتِ. This is the first ayah in Surah Al-Mumtahina. Extending to them affection while they have disbelieved in what came to you of the truth. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن تُطِيعُوا فَرِيقًا مِّنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ يَرُدُّوكُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ كَافِرِينَ. Again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exposes them for who they are, what is in their hearts. If you obey a party of those who were given the scripture, again, speaking of the Christians and the Jews, they would turn you back after your belief to being unbelievers. And how? And how could you disbelieve while to you are being recited the verses of Allah, and among you is His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and whoever holds firmly to Allah has indeed been guided to a straight path. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals another truth for us. وَلَن تَرْضَى عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَلَن نَصَارَى حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ. Again, I want you to understand that these are not my words. These are not the words of any man. This is our Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, informing us of the reality of these people. وَلَن تَرْضَى. And never will they be pleased with you. Whom? وَلَن تَرْضَى عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارَى. The Jews and the Christians, never will they be pleased with you. You think that they're happy with you because they, you know, they speak all those wonderful words and so on and so forth. No, no, no. وَإِنَّ مِنَ الْبَيَانِ لَسِحْرًا. And there is in the speech of some, magic, mesmerizing words, right? I mean, they speak so eloquently and, you know, they can really fake it to the extent that, you know, people will fall for it. So be cautious, beware of that. The reality though is in the Quran. وَلَن تَرْضَ عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَلَا النَّصَارَى. Never will they be pleased with you. حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ. Until such time that you start following their religion. وَدَّ كَثِيرٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ لَوْ يَرُدُّوكُمْ عَنْ دِينِكُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ كُفَّارًا حَسَدًا مِّنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Again, Allah Azza wa Jal exposes them. وَدَّ كَثِيرٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ. That many from the people of the book, what do they desire? What do they wish? They wish to turn you away from your religion after you had believed. حَسَدًا مِّنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Why? Because they are jealous of you. These are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا يَزَالُونَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ حَتَّى يَرُدُّوكُمْ عَنْ دِينِكُمْ إِنِ اسْتَطَاعُوا. And they will continue to oppose you. They will continue to fight you. Tooth and nail. Know it and know it well. They can make all the peace agreements with you. But in the end, no. They will oppose you somehow. Remember that the only way that they fight is not with the sword. No. This is where we got it wrong. Those bombs that they are throwing, those are not the most dangerous of things, by the way. What is more dangerous than that is what they are spreading in their magazines and over their television and their satellite stations. That is more dangerous. Look at how the minds of the Muslims have been corrupted. Yes, that is even more severe. That is even worse. Because then, once those poisoned minds are amongst us, they will spread that poison amongst others. Whether it be that they've convinced them to leave Islam, which is their ultimate goal, right? But, you know, they are a filthy people. They know that for the most part, they will not be able to take the Muslims away from their faith altogether. They know for the most part, iman is not an easy thing. You cannot turn, you know, that spark of faith that is in the hearts, you cannot turn it off. It's very difficult. They succeed in some cases. But if you look at the ummah at large, they do not, there's no great success in that. They haven't been so successful in turning people away from Islam and adopting some other religion. Maybe they've been able to fool a few, you know, by giving them medical treatment and housing them and clothing them and so on and so forth. But even with them, they eventually give up because these people afterwards, they ask them, and what more do you want from us? We've given you all this, right? Jesus is God, right? Yeah. And what else do you want? We want to go for Hajj. Oh, ya Allah. Damn. I mean, you know, from the heart, they couldn't take that iman away. Yeah, I mean, you know, the people went along with it for whatever reason. Ignorance, this, that, whatever else. And we see it. They maintain that there's some iman in them still. Ya subhanallah. So what do? Well, take them as far away from their religious practices as possible. Corrupt their minds as much as you can. Corrupt their hearts as much as you can. So they won't stand before us. And this is what they've been successful in. They've got us busy in our video games. They've got us busy in pornography. They've got us busy with, you know, filthy magazines, with all sorts of programs. So then, when we see what is happening around us, we say, may Allah help us. And that's all we have to say. Look at the condition of the youth. Our masajid are empty. Huh? Because we're too busy. I mean, the football is more important. Salatul Jama'ah, it's okay, it's sunnah. It's only sunnah. But of course, to watch the football match, it's fard. Fardu ayn, as a matter of fact, right? Not even fardu kifaya. This is the condition of the Muslims today. So they have been successful. وَلَا يَزَالُونَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ. So don't think they will continue to fight you only in the one way that you think about fighting. No. They can fight us in many ways. You know how, even one of the expressions, what does it say? That the pen is mightier than the sword. Yeah. And, you know, if the pen is mightier than the sword, and a picture is worth 1,000 words, why is a lot of pictures on TV? There's a lot of pictures on the satellite stations. So how much mightier are they than the sword? I think we're understanding what we're saying. وَلَا يَزَالُونَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ حَتَّى يَرُدُّوكُمْ عَنْ دِينِكُمْ إِنِ اسْتَطَاعُوا. If they are able, they will do whatever they can to take you away from your religion. So I want that we all understand these words. These are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But now, of course, we must qualify all of this. When we say that there is this hatred and this enmity, it doesn't have to do anything. It doesn't have anything to do with violence. This is not what we're speaking about. Being harsh and so on and so forth on the battlefield, that is one thing. Those are different ahkam. Those are different rulings altogether. But let's talk about our everyday life. Did the Prophet ﷺ go around and every time he saw a disbeliever, he tripped him or did something to inconvenience him? I mean, this is not how he treated them. This is not how he dealt with them. The Prophet ﷺ took gifts from them, correct? And even the Muslims were permitted to give gifts. Like when the Prophet one time Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu saw this jubba, this garment that he felt would be wonderful for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to wear, for example, on the day of Jumu'ah. And when he would meet delegations that came to him. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, we can't wear this. Okay? Whether it be because it's from silk, whatever it may be, this is not for us to wear. Then after that, many such garments were gifted to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he accepted them. They were gifts and he accepted them. Just like he accepted a silk garment, but because he couldn't wear it, then he gifted it to a woman. But these garments, then he gave one to Umar. Umar radiallahu anhu says, you want me to wear it after I heard you say what you said? He said, no. I didn't gift it to you so you could wear it. Oh, okay, I get it. So then he gave it as a gift to one of his mates in Makkah before that person even became a Muslim. Therefore, Imam al-Bukhari alayhi rahmatullah, one of the chapters that he has in his book, his collection of ahadith, is the chapter dealing with giving gifts to non-Muslims. Right? I mean, there has to be a balance. I mean, we have to think about our practical life. Today you live amongst non-Muslims, do you not? Even here, I mean, it's a Muslim country for the most part, but still you have non-Muslim neighbors. So if you were to go around and deal with them harshly all the time and, you know, inconvenience them and block their driveways and do all sorts of things, mashallah, what kind of da'wah is that? How are we going to be calling them to Islam? But rather, giving them gifts to show them that Islam is a great religion, to show them how Islam is an easygoing religion, alhamdulillah, but it has to be with that intention. Not, oh, here's a non-Muslim neighbor, and you know, to be in their good books, and so you can be good buddies, and so on and so forth. No, not for that reason. For that reason, you're not allowed to give gifts and befriend them, and so on and so forth. That is a great danger. I can tell you, you know, as a person who lives, or who comes from a land of the non-believers, I can tell you how dangerous that is. How many of our youth, leave alone the youth, even, you know, the older donkeys, how many of them have practically left Islam because of their strong relationships with non-Muslims, whether it be their neighbors or their classmates or people that they work with, colleagues at work, you know, just to be nice to them and wow, you know, so impressed by their lifestyles. And slowly but surely, yeah, subhanAllah, what happens? Their thinking changes, their dressing changes, their attitudes change. Then, you know, the five daily prayers are, you know, that's extreme. Going to the masjid at Fajr, that's extreme. You know, have to tone down a little bit. The cloak goes away, and, you know, the American hijab comes on. The tight jeans and the short, you know, shirts with the, you know, that all needs hijab on its own. I mean, really, their whole mindset is different. When we say that, you know, but they are non-Muslim, oh, don't say that, they're such good people. Really, you think that God's going to punish them? They're so nice, though. They will not understand the concept of tawheed and shirk. Shirk, the greatest crime, the one that Allah said He will never forgive. And when we say Allah will never forgive, it means if that person were to die upon that, then they have no chance of entering paradise. But, I mean, obviously, we can see the Sahaba, who were they? They were mushrikeen. Right? They were non-Muslims. They were pagans. Did Allah not forgive them? So obviously, we understand in context. It means if a person dies upon that, it is an unforgivable crime. But if a person in his or her lifetime repents from shirk, comes back, comes to Islam, alhamdulillah, then they are forgiven. So I hope we understand that part. I mean, I didn't say it before because it's a given. All right? So, I mean, these people, then their mindset changes. I think I told you the story about when Mother Teresa died. Like, people were all in up in arms. How could you say that, you know, she's a kafira? She's not, because she was a kafira. She was a non-Muslim. She heard about Islam. She knew about Islam, but she continuously called towards Christianity. What do you want me to do about it? I mean, don't call her a kafir because she's a kafir. What do you want me to call her? You know? End of story. But it's that whole mindset. Oh, you can't judge people. What do you mean I can't judge people? What do they do in courts? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has judged already. I'm not judging. I mean, I don't say ultimately that individual for sure is going to end up in the hellfire. The person is still alive. They may still become Muslim. Right? I mean, it's not my job to do that. But in general terms, yeah, I mean, they are innamal mushrikuna najis. They are filthy people. Filthy in their in their beliefs. Right? What they carry in their hearts of disbelief. That doesn't mean that I have such hatred. I have hatred for what they stand for. I have hatred for that disbelief that is in them. But does it mean that I have to be violent towards them? No, they are my neighbors, they are my classmates and whatever else. I should feel sorry for them. I should have pity on them. I should feel compassion towards them. That enmity, if you want to call it that then, will drive me to do something for them, to call them towards Islam. Not to drive them away from Islam. And what I'm opposed to is their disbelief. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I told you about the gifting, it's not for the purpose of just, you know, striking up friendships. If it's for that purpose, it's a great no-no, because that would lead you to the wrong way, right? And that's why the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam told us al-mar'u ma'a man yuhib. Also, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam told that a person will be with those whom he loves. So you end up having these, you know, feelings of you know, this great friendship and love for that person. Okay, you want to be with them in the hereafter, in the hellfire? That's up to you. No, you strike up a friendship, if you will, so that you can call them towards Islam. Yes, this is what we're after. So you could explain to them the beauty of your religion and show them the greatness of your religion. This is what we're after. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, did he not visit a Jewish neighbor, the youth who's on his deathbed? And when he went to him, did he say, oh, how's it going? Hope you get better soon. And, you know, and that's the end of the story. Is that all he went for? No. He went for a much greater purpose. He reminded him, listen, you adopt what I'm telling you now. You believe it in your heart. Because they understood the Arabic language. You know, he didn't simply say to him, say these words and, you know, you're going to go to heaven just because you say them. No. If that was the case, then all the people of Makkah to be spared of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to be spared of his message and to get him off their backs, they would have all said, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, and gone on their merry way. But they knew when he said, Qulu la ilaha illallah, he meant with your hearts first. So he understood. So that neighbor of his, he went to visit that youth who was on his deathbed, and he reminded him that he should say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. In other words, to accept it in his heart, sincerely. And as a result of it, the Prophet ﷺ would intercede on his behalf and he would be entered into paradise. And what did the father say? Atir Abul Qasim. Obey Abul Qasim. So yes, this is the purpose behind those friendships, if you want to call them. If you want to call them that. Yes, it's good. It's okay to accept gifts from them, to give them gifts even. Yes, all of that is acceptable if your niyyah, if your intention is that you want to show them the greatness of Islam, how easygoing we are as Muslims, how forbearing we are as Muslims, then absolutely it is from the sunnah, we can say, of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He accepted that, you know, the sheep that was given to him as a gift, he accepted clothing that came to him as a gift. From whom? From non-Muslims. Some of them were Jews. A Jewish woman is the one who sent that meat for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All right. So we don't want to go to any extremes. We want to understand the whole matter. Yes. What is it that we are disliking? What is it that we are hating? And I think I've told you before about Imam Malik rahimahullah, that he couldn't even bear to look at the cross. If he saw a cross, he would turn away and he would look down. Why? Because that is a symbol of kufr, a symbol of disbelief. So this is what it's about. It's about iman. It's about faith. It's about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When people are upon disbelief, what are they doing? Who are they opposing? They are opposing Allah. They are rejecting Allah. These people are headed towards the hellfire. You want to go with them? No. But you, as a human being, Don't you want to save them? This is why the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, what did he say after the father said to the Jewish father says to his son, obey Abu al-Qasim, that is the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and the boy accepted and he became a Muslim. Then as he was walking away, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام said, Alhamdulillah الذي أنقذه بي من النار. Then all praises belong to Allah who saved him through me from the hellfire. Okay, so this is what we're about. We want good for the people, we want good for all of humanity. We do not want them to go to hell. What am I going to benefit and what are you going to benefit if all of these people on earth go to hell? Does it give me more place in Jannah? Allah has plenty. Whatever Allah has is never depleted. There's enough to go around. So we'd rather that everybody go to paradise. We don't want people to go to hell, no. Quite to the contrary. So when we understand it, we have that balanced understanding, then inshallah ta'ala in our daily lives, we will not have problems. But there are some who allow, their zeal, which is misplaced, their misplaced enthusiasm, and their misunderstanding of the text, that gets the better of them. And so, as happened previously in Egypt, for example, tourists would be, traveling in a bus, and they're going to blow the bus up. What did you gain? And the driver may have been a Muslim, for example. And what do we gain from that? If we were to go around the streets of Cayenne and blow up churches, and what are we going to gain from that? Are we going to get anywhere? No, we're not going to get anywhere. So we have to have the proper understanding so we do not overstep, overstep the bounds. Blood is sacred. Blood is sacred. Even the blood of the non-Muslim is protected in Islam. And non-Muslims, are categorized into four different categories. That's a topic on its own. But, we're talking about every day. These are people who live side by side with us. They are citizens of the country. They are protected by law and so on. And so it's not in our hands to take those lives. It is haram for us to do so. It is haram according to clear-cut texts in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I hope inshallah ta'ala this clarifies the matter because, people will explain things according to whatever agenda that they may have. But we want to explain according to the Quran and the Sunnah, so we have that balanced view inshallah ta'ala, and we can live by it, and we can identify when people are going to any extremes. Hada wallahu ta'ala a'lam, wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Are there any questions or comments? Alaykum as-salam.
Maybe this question has been asked before. In our political scenario here, where Muslims and non-Muslims to be elected, even live in an area where the candidates are non-Muslim, how do you go about that?
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ma wala wa ba'd. To be frank with you, I'm not familiar with your local politics, but in general, the way the systems are set up, although there's a lot of talk even amongst the scholars about, the elections and so on and so forth, personally, I'm speaking about now, my own view on these things, I lived by that, alhamdulillah, all my life, and I continue to do so. I mean, right now I have the right to vote even in my country. And the people say, many amongst the Muslims say that you should, at least, that's the only way you can bring about change and so on and so forth. I don't buy it. I don't buy the whole system. I don't buy any of that. And at the end of the day, what you have to ask yourself, what I have to ask myself is, on the day of Qiyamah, when I stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He questions me about this, about dropping that ballot, do I have an excuse? Do I have something that I'm confident in that, Ya Allah, I did it, and I absolutely believe that it was the right thing to do? Me, I can't think of any good excuse that I can find. That I voted for this non-Muslim in this system who, may be pro-gay and whatever else, but it so happens that he's, anti-something else. Am I confident enough to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say that, it was the right thing for me to do? I'm not, and so I don't. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. So I'm not the right guy to ask that question. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.